الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم على ألا تعدلوا، اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى، واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. صدق الله العظيم. الله سبحانه وتعالى says that disliking any person should not force you and should not make you do injustice. اعدلوه أقرب للتقوى. Always hold to justice. That is the closest way to taqwa. The reason this ayah just came to my mind yesterday, I just mentioned one thing that was how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dealt with his enemies, with people who did not like him, with people who tried to hurt him. Although this is a very long topic, and during the month of Ramadan, there is no time to go through books to search for anything. If we look into the books of Seerah, we would be able to find a lot about this topic. And the reason I'm mentioning it so that hopefully, inshallah, we can some other time refer to the books of Seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and study this topic in the light of the ahadith, how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to deal with those who did not like him or who mistreated him. But just to have few examples of it that will open up our minds towards understanding it, and at the same time, inshallah, will give us the understanding of how we are supposed to behave in these type of situations. What should be our reaction to those who either they try to hurt us sometime, or they don't like us. A lot of time in our situation, a person who may have done something years and years ago, and that person may even have forgotten of what he has done, or may never had an intention to do this, but we would remember it forever. And of course, as there are ahadiths that talk about different types of people, so there are people who really remember these things. There are some people who remember when people do some favors to them, and they will remember it forever, and they will always be nice to those people. There are people who don't remember favors. They only remember when people try to hurt them. And they would remember this forever. And no matter what this person would do later on, every time this thing is going to come up. But remember, one day this is what he tried to do. This is who this person is. This is the person who once he tried to do this to me. God forbid, if someone has that type of personality, it is very destructive. And it is one of those raza'il, those evils, those diseases of the heart, of the soul, that we need to work on and purify it. These personalities, of course, they do exist. That remembering only hatred, disliking. And there are some people who remember both, good and bad. They will always remember it. And I think maybe a good personality, a person who forgets everything. He doesn't care. But this type of personality where a person would remember every bad thing from any person, then one day this person tried to do this to me, the other day he tried to do this to me, this is totally against the akhlaq that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, After when he came back from Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, from the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, so his enemies were extremely upset because they knew that Sulh al-Hudaybiyah is a great victory really for Islam. And it was a great achievement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to have that type of treaty with the Kuffar of Quraysh, who were considered to be the strongest enemy in that area. So now, he is going to be satisfied from this side and he will be dealing now with other people. Some people in Medina Munawwara went to a person who pretended to be a munafiq, originally Yahud, and he was pretending that he is Muslim, but he was not. This person was a munafiq. His name was Labid ibn al-Asam. So some of those people went to Labid ibn al-Asam and said to him that, listen, we tried our best to do some magic on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and nothing is working, and you are the best person in this field. If you would do something that would have an effect on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will give you great gifts, or we will pay you for that. And they really gave him a lot to do it. And this person did that magic on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For some time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had the effect of it also on himself, until when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him of the treatment of it and of all the details of it, of who had done it and where this person have kept the objects here of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the comb of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and other things on which he had done his magic. It was in a well somewhere. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he got all the information, he went there to the well and he took everything out. Remember, the person who did it now, he is not a person who openly claims kufr. Yes, he was asked by those people, but the one who did it himself is not a person who openly claims kufr. This person claims Islam. So in other words, he comes to the masjid. But on his face, he's nice. On his back, this is what he has done. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not inform the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi ajma'in of the name of this person. Ali radiallahu anhu, Zubayr radiallahu anhu, and some other Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi ajma'in requested Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to inform them of the name and to take revenge from the person, do something about this person. We got to do something so that other people won't take advantage of it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's response was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had protected me against everything he had done. Yes, I had the effect, but now it's gone. So once it's gone, why do I need to take revenge from this person? If the person tried to hurt me, why should I try to hurt the person in return? Yes, if it was before, this thing would go away, we would try to tell the person, talk to the person, so that we work something with him, so he would take this away. But now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken the effect of it away. That effect is gone, so I don't need to talk to this person either. Therefore, I will not even mention it. And the amazing part of the hadith, Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi ajma'in say that after some time, he informed some of the close Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi ajma'in about that person's name. That was Labid ibn al-Asam. But those Sahaba say that when this Labid ibn al-Asam would come and sit in the gathering of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَا رُؤِيَ فِي وَجْهِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ
You could not even tell by looking at Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's face that he is disliking the person. And Labid did not know that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam already is informed by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he knows that you are the person who did it. He never knew about it. So he comes and said that he would normally said like other Muslims, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam never showed, even on his face, it was never seen that he disliked this person. It's easy really to read these type of hadith. But if we look at our souls, we all may remember someone who dislikes us. Someone who tried to do something against us. And then we see our feeling towards those people. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was in Makkah Mukarramah, we know how the kuffar always plotted against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How they were day and night planning to do something against him, to hurt him. In fact, they tortured some of the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that some of them they even died under that torture. And many of them who survived, they had marks on their bodies that were permanent, just like Khabbab radiallahu anhu, on his back, he had deep holes. When Umar radiallahu anhu saw these holes in the back of Khabbab radiallahu anhu, then the holes, it says in some of the narrations, were such that a child playing would put his finger into it. So, Umar radiallahu anhu asked him, what happened, Khabbab? Why do you have these things in your back? He said, because when the kuffar used to lay me down, when they were torturing me in Makkah Mukarramah, they used to lay me down on burning coals. And they would leave me there until my own blood and the fat of my body would put that off. Imagine a person is laying down on burning coals. And not only this, marks on his head, on his face. What are these from? They used to burn the metal, iron rod into a fire until it will get red, and they would put it on my head. And they would keep on doing that, requiring from me that I should turn away from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know what Bilal radiallahu anhu went through. What Ammar radiallahu anhu went through. His mother was killed right before his own eyes. Abu Jahl killed his mother. They killed his father. But those who became Muslims later on out of these people, and we know that majority of these people who were doing these things, they became Muslims later on. These Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'een, whether it was Bilal or Khabbab or Ammar, they never showed any attitude towards those people, any reaction that it was you who used to do this to me. They never did it. They were living like true brothers, always working together, helping each other in everything. Never had that feeling in their hearts, in their minds, that you are the one who did this once to me. They never even reminded them. Akrimah bin Abu Jahl, as he became Muslim. And we know what Abu Jahl did against Islam. In fact, he went beyond any limit and every limit. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, that my Fir'aun is worse than the Fir'aun of Bani Israel of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. My Fir'aun is worse than that Fir'aun. And we could really see that this Fir'aun was much worse than that Fir'aun. Because, you know, that Fir'aun still had his own weaknesses. When he was dying, that Fir'aun, when he was dying, he shouted, "La ilaha amantu annahu la ilaha illa alladhi amanat bihi banu Israel." I believe in the same Lord of Bani Israel. وأنا من المسلمين. I'm a Muslim. Quran says that he was shouting and crying at the time of when he was drowning. فلما أدركه الغرق قال آمنت أنه لا إله إلا الذي آمن به بنو إسرائيل. When he was drowning, he started shouting that I believe in the same God. But this Fir'aun, Abu Jahl, Abu Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu is sitting on his chest. And Abu Jahl knows that the next thing this person is going to do is cut my throat. So he says, Abdullah, don't use your sword, use mine because it's a better one. He doesn't want to be insulted by getting killed by that bad sword. It has to be a good sword that's used for me. And then Abdullah, make sure when you cut my neck, cut it all the way from the bottom. So when all the heads are put together, my heads will be higher than other heads. He's making this is his last will and his request. That you're going to cut my throat. Okay, that's fine, do it. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said to him, that what are you thinking about at this time? Is this the time to talk about this? Don't you see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how he humiliated you? So he says, so what? There are still people behind me who will continue this work. This is the Fir'aun of this Ummah. But when his son, Ikrimah, radiyallahu anhu, became Muslim, in the hadith of the Mustadrak Hakim, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gathered the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in and he announced, لا تؤذوا الحي بالميت, or كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, that don't hurt the feeling of the living person because of saying anything against that dead person, which means don't say anything against Abu Jahl anymore, because it will hurt the feeling of his son. After all, that was his father. So since his son now today becoming Muslim and is coming to us, so from now on, no one should talk against Abu Jahl. This was the official ruling issued by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لا تسب الميت فتؤذي الحي. Don't curse at the dead person to hurt the feeling of a living person. That was it. We would say, at least, you know, his father did all of this and he knows about it and he is Muslim, he should do the same thing that I'm saying, doing. But no. This is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's akhlaq. That person who spent all of his life against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but finally Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is stopping Sahaba from even talking against him. During the Battle of Hudaybiyah, Treaty of Hudaybiyah, now they're talking about having a treaty. But a group of 80 kuffar, they thought, during this period, if we can somehow attack Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and kill him, that would take care of everything. So 80 of them, they came at night time. Muhammad ibn Maslama radiyallahu anhu, it is a Sahabi who was guarding Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he was standing outside of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's tent. He says, all of a sudden I see a large group of people coming towards us. All the other Sahaba are sleeping. I'm standing at the door of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's tent. And he was resting inside. I informed him, Ya Rasulullah, I see that there is a good large group of them coming. He made some dua. And all of those people went blind. They could not see anything. And I started capturing them one after another. And I tried all of them. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he wanted, he could have really taken a good revenge from these people and from the kuffar of Quraysh at this time. But no. Before morning, he sits with all of these people and he says to them, what you people were plotting was very bad. This is against humanity, this is against morality. We are talking, we are discussing freely with you people. And this is what you people are trying to do? Okay, make sure you don't do this again. Go back. SubhanAllah. It's just like you're sitting with your own son. Son, this is bad. Don't do it again, okay? Okay, go. This is how he's treating those people. Sometimes we don't even treat our own children that way. We will be shouting, cursing. But do see what I'm doing for you. I'm doing all of this. None of that. Muhammad ibn Muslim says, I was so surprised that I thought now I have some opportunity. And he mentioned, this is happening after the treaty. After they had discussed all the treaty and everything, this is happening. And if you remember, at that time, a person whose name was Abu Jundal radiallahu anhu, the son of Suhail ibn Amr, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he started shouting and he started crying that, Ya Rasulullah, I'm Muslim, and because I'm Muslim, these people have really been torturing me. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Suhail ibn Amr, that Suhail, allow this person to come with us. It was part of the treaty that any Muslim comes from Makkah to Medina, he will be returned. They had not signed the treaty yet. They are still discussing these conditions. And that Abu Jindal comes. As Abu Jindal came and he requested, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Suhail, okay, he can come. Suhail said, no. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, we didn't sign the treaty yet. He said, still. And if we don't return this person to us, then we are not signing it. He said, okay, let's take it the other way. Just for my sake, hand this person to us. It will be just like you doing me a favor to me. If you look at reality, it's not a favor. Treaty is not signed yet. So those conditions are not applicable yet. But as this person is just being stubborn and insisting, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, just for my sake, let him go. He said, no, I won't even do that. And he says, yes, bala, fa'fa'al, please, do it. Rasulullah is requesting the person in that way. Okay, please, do it. He says, no, I'm not doing it. Next day, this Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his control, he has 80 people of them. At least he could say, okay, now I have 80 people in my hand. If you send Abu Jindal, I'll send the 80 people back. He sits with them, talks to them, very nicely, explains to them that this is what you're doing is bad. Okay, go back. That's it. And we know when he conquered Makkah Mukarramah. And everyone was afraid, all the kuffar were afraid, that today he's going to take the revenge from us for everything that we have done. Especially the ones who are leading it. The ones who are very actively taking part in it. Today he's going to do everything to take revenge from us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went by the Kaaba. And he said to Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhi wa sallam that bring all of these people here around the Kaaba. When they gathered over there, he started his khutbah. And he asked them, what do you think I'm supposed to do with you people now? They said, oh Muhammad, you're always being nice. See, this is the time when they remember it. Muhammad, you are so nice. You are a good brother. You had been a good brother always. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I will tell you the same thing that Yaqub alayhi salatu wa sallam said to his sons, لا تثريب عليكم اليوم يغفر الله لكم وهو أرحم الراحمين, that there is nothing against you today. I'm not holding anything against you today. That I'm not trying to punish you. I won't try to hurt you. May Allah forgive you. اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. Go back. All of you are free. Where in the world we find these examples?